Hi. I'm Kyle, and tonight I'm going to graduate from high school. But before I do, I want to talk to you about awareness. About 6 months ago, Vijay told our religious fundamentalism class that most people can only pay attention for about 10 minutes, so I really hope you've all been spacing out until now. There's this boy laying on a grassy field, and he's staring up at the sea of stars. This is one of those kids who spends his whole life wanting to be an astronaut. So he's just lying there slack-jawed, and the universe laughs at him and asks, "What are you looking for?" And the boy replies, "I'm looking for answers." And then he pauses for a moment before saying, "I'm ready to leave the Earth. Will you take me into space?" And the universe replies, "Just show me where the boundary is." Ladies and gentlemen, today we're all gathered to celebrate a very special occasion. This is the moment we've all been waiting for years or maybe even lifetimes. It's time for us to come together in what I can only assume will be one of the most meaningful experiences of our lives. I'm referring, of course, to the birthdays of John McClure and Jordan Fong. I think that at some point in our lives, we become disenchanted with birthdays. We realize how arbitrary they are, how easily life goes on. Maybe we stay up until midnight like Harry Potter before his 11th birthday, wondering why we expected anyone to care as much as we did. There's this problem in philosophy called the paradox of the heap. Let's say you have an empty lot and you start adding just individual grains of sand one at a time. We can agree that no single grain makes the difference between a heap and a non-heap. The paradox is that eventually enough single grains of sand become a heap, which of course begs the question, at what point does a non-heap become a heap? Our class theme this year was Back to the Future. So today, I'm going to take you all on a journey from the past to the future and finally to the present. So let's start our journey by traveling back in time. In case any of you were expecting me to reveal that I was the boy staring at the stars, I want to take this chance to admit that I never wanted to be an astronaut. I wanted to be a house husband. I'm not going to stand up here and tell you about a grand life-altering revelation I had while laying in a field. The point of the story is simply that focusing on abstract theoreticals can prevent us from appreciating the specific and palpable present. I'll get back to that eventually, but right now I want to explain why any of this matters. So I'm taking us back to fifth grade. I brought my yearbook, and I know you're all too far to see, but that's me in the upper right. Now, if you can imagine a shorter version of myself with hair that looks kind of like an inverted black bowl, you'll have a pretty good idea. We were all allowed to write a sentence about our interests, so I wrote, "I really like hard math problems." The girl underneath me wrote, "I like my friends, Pokemon and Recess." I've changed since then, and I think it's safe to say that we all have. OES has had a tremendous impact on all of us. It's been my home away from home for 4 years, and it's often become my primary home during Tech Week. I'm not going to stand up here and try to define myself, but I think it's clear that I've grown since fifth grade. And so I find myself wondering how I managed to travel so far and become a full-fledged heap, moving just one grain of sand at a time. The solution to the paradox of the heap is to realize that no matter how gradual the growth, what really matters is coming together and creating an agreed-upon differentiation. And so tonight we gather in ritual celebration just to make it absolutely clear that the class of 2013 is done with high school. Just to be absolutely clear that no one tries to show up for school on Monday. Now, most of us can agree that the legal definition of adulthood is somewhat arbitrary. There's no real reason to base it on rotations of the Earth around the sun, and of course, there's just as no grain makes a heap, no day can turn a minor into an adult, and no single class period can turn a student into a graduate. But with the help of birthday candles and graduation ceremonies, we've been given the power to transform ourselves overnight. There's this boy laying on a grassy field staring up at the sea of stars. This is one of those kids who spends his whole life wanting to be an astronaut. So of course he's thinking about how wonderful it would be to join the stars. How wonderful it would be if the planet could just let go for a moment and allow him to float away. And into the darkness, the boy whispers, "I want to go to space." And beneath him, the world continues to turn, indifferent to his desires. So now it's time for us to go back to the future. It's clear that we'll soon cease to be high school students, but the term graduate is actually a pretty horrible descriptor. It refers only to a past event, in this case, the end of high school, with no real mention of what happens next. If you've ever done something bad without suffering from serious repercussions, an adult has probably taken you to the side and said something along the lines of, "You won't be able to do that kind of thing in the real world." And for some of us, the real world starts tomorrow or tonight. And for some, it'll start in college or when you get your first job or have a child or a house. The point being that the line between whatever we're currently in and the real world is subject to the same scrutiny as the line between minor and adult, or heap and non-heap. But as I've already explained, the fact that those lines are arbitrary doesn't make them any less important. There's a lot of really good things I could say about how well our liberal arts education has prepared us for the future. But as I'm sure you've noticed, I'm much more interested in talking about sand and space than I am about relieving any worries you might have. Though, as your only graduation speaker, I do feel some responsibility. Responsibility I've decided to delegate. Because tonight we're gathered together and we have all these adults, there's an incredible wealth of wisdom and experience in this room. And I can't help but feel that it deserves to be appreciated. And so I have a humble request, a class activity, if you will. For all the adults gathered here tonight, Mo talked about the ups and downs of life, but if you feel like your life, for the most part, has been livable, okay, all right, whatever word you want to use, I ask you now to stand up and face the class of 2013. And so you can see that no matter what life throws at you, it really isn't that bad, because life turns out okay. Thank you, you can all sit down now. So now that that's out of the way and all your worries about the future are gone forever, I'd like to explain why I'm so reluctant to talk about it in the first place. Simply put, I feel guilty telling people that everything will turn out okay because I can't make any promises. Because like Mo said, there are ups and downs and sometimes you dip too far. One night while stumbling through the school library in the middle of the night, an activity you should all look forward to in college, Harry Potter discovers the Mirror of Erised. And looking into it, he sees himself reunited with lost parents. Of course, Dumbledore walks in and explains that the mirror shows us nothing more or less than the deepest, most desperate desires of our hearts. However, this mirror will give us neither knowledge or truth. It does not do to dwell on dreams and forget to live. The mirror shows a perfect image, one complete with your heart's strongest wishes, but no matter how wonderful, the image remains nothing more than a reflection, shielded by cold glass. Whether you're worrying about the future or looking forward to it, you're living somewhere other than the present, and that's never good. You dread the future, you're torturing yourself with something that doesn't exist. We call people like that insane. If you live your life constantly wishing for a better world, you're just adding grains of sand one at a time. And unless you take the time to really appreciate the heap, it will never be big enough to satisfy you. Of course, the much more optimistic good news tonight is that you do get a choice in the matter. If your liberal arts education has given you nothing else, it's given you the power to choose how you view and experience the world. So now I've talked about a hypothetical boy, a theoretical heap, and a literary wizard. They aren't exactly from the past or future, but they're also definitively not real, at least not in the same way we are. I brought you to the present, so now let's ground this in reality. You're at a high school graduation. You're sitting in this fancy cathedral thinking about how beautiful everything is, about how strange it is to have a podium shaped like an eagle, and how this boy seems to just be droning on and on and on about God knows what. And as your mind starts to wander further and further away, you pull yourself back, remembering how important this is to your loved one. So you come back to reality, thinking perhaps that moments like this one really ought to be paid attention to. And so just for a moment, you find yourself fully immersed and grounded in the present. My request tonight is that you remember that feeling and hold on to it, because it's not just important moments that deserve to be experienced. It's every moment, no matter how mundane or routine or ordinary. Meaningful events don't create awareness. Awareness makes events meaningful. So here we are. There's this boy laying on a grassy field. He's staring up at the sea of stars, wishing over and over again that he could go into space, and he's lying on this field, feeling himself sinking in, getting lost in the stars. And in this moment, the boy realizes that in spite of all the humans and the atmosphere and the warmth, the Earth is in space too. And whether you realize or not, our journeys through the universe have already begun.